The following program was made possible thanks to the generous support of our Kickstarter backers.
Well, first Holmes was born, then he got fat, bald, and tired.
Sup, Holmes?
Beware your host,
well,
Jonathan!
Thanks, Sinistar, as always, and thank you, Chris and Kate, last minute invites to Sup, Holmes today on Sunday, the 15th of November, I think, already. Man, how is it going with you guys Sunday afternoon?
Well, we're on the West Coast, so it's Sunday morning. So our experience has been kind of like waking up from a late Saturday to, hey, do you want to stream in a few minutes? So
thank you.
Hopefully we won't look like zombies or say anything too dumb.
You both look fantastic. That's Chris and Kate from Beardo Games, working on the game Smooth Operator, a game that I'm just learning about now. I actually heard about it a little bit last week from the Read Only Memories tweet. Apparently, one of the characters from Read Only Memories is going to be in there. Read Only Memories, a fun point-and-click game in the school of Snatcher, deals with a lot of interesting themes, comedy, cuteness, similar to what you guys are dealing with, though you may be redefining cuteness.
Yeah, I don't know how cute it is. It's pretty icky, but I will say when the Read Only team kind of saw it, they were like, you have to put all of our characters in there. And we've gotten some feedback from kind of the read-only core fan base that they really want to make out with Tomcat. So it makes sense.
And Tomcat is the poofy hair?
Yeah, the hacker with the pink hair. And that was actually an art challenge in our game because we show characters from both sides in profile. And for most of our 20 characters, they're pretty much the same on either side, but we had to do a little fiddling to accommodate the two-tone hair. So, cool.
So when it flips, you get both sides of Tomcat.
Yes.
Yeah, we didn't want to have this Street Fighter II style Sagat eye patch staying, you know, flipping sides depending on which side of the screen he was on. So,
exactly.
Sure. These little details make a big difference. So, how long have you been working on Smooth Operator for?
Essentially forever. There was, kind of infancy and toddlerhood. And then as soon as we were reading and writing, we feel like we were working on this game. But in all seriousness, 2013, there was a game jam. We do Ludum Dare quite regularly, which is a worldwide game jam with a huge community. So we love it. You get on Twitter, you get on IRC, you make new friends who are all jamming on games. And the theme for this particular one was 10 seconds. So kind of an obviously time-based theme. And our overwhelming goal when we approach Ludum Dare themes is how to subvert them and make them something completely different because, I don't know, we don't want to do things other people are doing. And whatever that first impulse is probably something someone else also thought of. So we keep working and brainstorming until we think we have something that is probably going to be novel. And so we thought, kind of riffing on the idea of seconds. And after several beers, we came up with second base and kind of adolescent baseball analogies for certain things. And so how do you get to second base? You have to be really good at first base. So it became a tongue-kissing game. And you had to kiss 10 different people to a point where you would progress. And then the game faded to black. And our artist, Miles Nielsen, said in a really creepy voice, second base. So
so do you ever actually see second base happen or a second base?
No, we thought that was too hard to take on in a 48-hour game jam. So
yeah. Sure. It's a whole game.
Everything from the neck up. So.
Sure. Makes a lot of sense. So do you have 10 seconds to, in the original version anyway, is that how long you get to tongue kiss for?
Gosh. No, it's
been a long time. I don't think it wasn't time-based. You could go on indefinitely if you were doing it really bad, like, and never win that level, as it were.
Uh-huh. So it was 10 times you get to second base.
Yes.
10 second bases.
Exactly. Yes.
That's tricky.
Yeah. The game's actually still out there on our website. A link to download it. It's pretty primitive. Don't expect a lot.
Of course, you're saying that, and I looked at our website a couple weeks ago. I think it might not be there.
Oh, whoops.
But You can try.
And Ludum Dare or Ludum Dare, they put up stuff sometimes on their own. Is it still on that page somewhere?
There's definitely a description of it on their page, and you can link to the Ludum Dare site for the game from our website for sure if you want to see some of the art and some of the feedback we got. The best feedback being that the main character of the jam game looked like Neil Young. So if you ever wanted to make out, I'm not sure who said it, someone who we're friends with on Twitter, but if you ever wanted to make out as Neil Young 10 times, it was the game for you.
And is there a mirror match? Do you get to make out with Neil Young as a Neil Young?
We've been talking about this for a long time. About whether that's something we're going to do. In the jam game, you could just play as the one character. And it was the Neil Young looking guy, who kind of is our artist avatar, I guess you could call him.
It's a weird alter ego for Miles.
Yeah.
The character's name is Mutton, as for his mutton chops. But flashing forward into Smooth Operator, it's got 20 characters, more than. They can all make out with each other. There's crossover characters. Right now, the mirror match is not enabled because we need to go back and make some additional color swap art, a la Street Fighter or Tekken, you know, when you match up the same character, they don't look exactly the same. So we are planning that maybe for our first update after we get the main game out.
Cool. So you've given it thought. You've given so much of this a lot of thought. What started as a 48-hour game?
I think we did the 72-hour version because, the core of Ludum Dare is the 48 hours, but it's usually for people who are working solo. If you're doing just the jam, not the competition, you're allowed to use 72 hours. And I think we availed ourselves of that.
I was pretty much at 6 p.m. Pacific time on Monday, throwing the last couple things in there and desperately uploading it, crossing my fingers.
You gave it all you had. You put so much of yourself for 3 days into this, shocking, stimulating, and inherently stimulating. Do you think that's what it was? Like, as soon as you see it, at least as soon as I saw it, I felt like I was gonna laugh, and I hated like the human race. I hated all kissing, and I thought kissing was hilarious, and I wanted to do it like all at the same time. Like,
yeah, there's a lot of very mixed feelings and very mixed reactions. Like, there's nothing like a 12-year-old boy walking by saying, "That's absolutely disgusting," when I'm playing the game with his mom. So there's definitely a lot of layers in there. Our thing above all else is not to take it too seriously. Sure. It's a silly adolescent game. It's supposed to be gross. If it made you uncomfortable, well, isn't that amazing that, you know, this cartoony characters on a screen on an iPad could give you an emotional response? So.
And do you think it was the fact that you got a response within your own team from it pretty quickly that inspired you to continue to work on it for, what, 2.5 years now?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it hasn't necessarily been three people all, you know, 60 hours a week for that whole time. We all have day jobs and we kind of fit it in. But yeah, we got a lot of response from people we're friends with who were like, "I want you to put this on a phone so I can play it with all my friends out at the bar or at the party or whatever. Just make it really accessible." And then another feedback we got on it was that there was no in-game feedback on how you were doing. So we wanted to kind of think about taking it in another direction where it wasn't as minimal. And it had a lot of really over-the-top video game feedback conventions, like stars flying and meters building up and combos building and things like that. And then the super moves as well. So,
yeah, I wanted to get to that. So how do you even play it? I haven't played it myself yet. I watched the trailer a few times. Can't believe the use of Cameo's word up slowed down.
Ooh.
It makes me feel even worse.
It's actually going away.
I saw it while I could, and I know the feeling. We used to use Chromio in our old Destructoid videos. Thought, oh, Chromio won't mind. It's not like we're getting rich off this trailer. Boy, did they mind. You'll never see those videos again.
Well, that's a good moment to mention. Our musician is really amazing, Montgomery Word, who's out of Portland here, has a Facebook, has a Bandcamp. look that up. Don't sleep.
Montgomery Ward. What kind
Montgomery of Montgomery Ward?
Style? Does he have a style you can sum up?
He's very eclectic, but he does a lot of things with multi-layer sounds, and that's sampling. And that's how the cameo got in there. But we're kind of going back through and being a little bit self-critical about what we actually push in the app. Even though I love some of those things with the very distinctive samples, it's not gonna fly.
Yeah, he does a lot of work that doesn't sample copyrighted material. So,
yeah, we have a deep bench with his tracks. Yeah. But what was the original question?
Before I will restate it in a moment, but before I forget, you can sample me in any way you want.
I've been doing things for a while.
Yeah, any not that you'd want to, but I've said things for years now. Any of them. They're all yours. Montgomery Ward can use in any way you want. The question was, I think, gameplay.
Yes.
What happens when you're playing it?
Well, so there's two. We originally started out with the idea of making it kind of like Street Fighter, where you'd have combos and you'd have different kinds of moves that you could do. But it kind of breaks down. Well, I should also say, and then on Supers, if you do well. But it kind of breaks down the whole Street Fighter analogy. When
it's not really versus.
Yeah, it's not versus at all. You're cooperating to get to, do I want to say the word climax? I guess that's the best way to describe it.
Yeah, but so there's a core game now in the current build. It's gone through many iterations, some of which were just, you know, flat out embarrassing, up through what we've got now, which we like a lot. There's a guide arrow in the center of the screen, and you swipe on your side of the screen, kind of following what the guide arrow is doing in the center, swiping. If you can see my hand, that made it so much clearer.
It's working. Yeah. So yeah. It's like, it looked to me kind of like DDR, except with swiping and following, tracing at times. All the while, the backdrop is this. No lips.
No lips.
For those who haven't seen it yet, and you're picturing tongue kissing, maybe you've been doing it wrong this whole time. Apparently, what you're supposed to do, open your mouth as wide as you
get
can.
Get it as far out there as you can.
Yeah. And then try to just make someone feel good by also rubbing the, and they've also decided to stick their tongue out as far as they can. And even sometimes the tongues are so coordinated, and it's just a super move, where the tongue can greet another tongue in what looks like a sort of tongue-hand shake. Is that right?
Yeah, so basically you play that core game where you're swiping, and then if you do well enough with that one, and there's different objectives for different stages in it, you'll trigger the opportunity to have a super move. And then you go into a truly co-op gameplay mode where there's a heart on the screen, you both get your finger on that heart, and then you chase it all over the screen. And in harder levels, it goes faster, and it's got that meta thing a little bit, because your fingers could touch, and depending on how much is unsaid between you, you might giggle. Has that, you know, awkward, especially if you're playing on a phone instead of a tablet, because then you have to be really close doing it. On the completion of that, you get kind of a little reward for doing it well. It plays the animation for the super move, which in one case is an elaborate handshake that includes some fist bumps as well as traditional handshake.
If I remember correctly, the loading screen is like fist bumps and pointers and like, I like you, but I'm not going to touch you yet. I'm just going to be a hand friend.
Yeah, yes. And Miles really likes drawing hands. So you see that come up throughout the game. So the handshake is one. Every one of the 11 stages has a unique super move. So there's 11 different super moves. Ranging from ones where you could be like, okay, maybe tongues could twist together. Maybe tongues could do a wave back and forth together. Maybe tongues could play an air guitar together. But then there's some very non-representational abstract ones. There's one that involves...
Like cubes?
A little bit. There's one that involves pizza, and there's one that involves kittens.
Because of course there is.
And it actually, having 11 stages, like as a team, we were doing the idea generation, and you know, some of the ideas were very easy and, you know, came up with first, like, oh, they could tie in a knot. That seems pretty straightforward. And but when we got to like the last ones, it was just like, we're coming up dry. And so then it got really weird. That's all I'll say.
Yeah.
And sometimes pushing it. I mean, what it seems like, and I'm glad you brought this up. I was just about to ask, like, there are certain jokes in my life that I've done and I was sad because I was like, I thought that was funny, but it went over not that well. But then I decided to keep pushing it and pushing it. And then like somehow, because I was bonding with the people who hated my joke and I showed that I hated it too. And like, I kind of hate everything in that moment and feel just so bad. We shared in that badness and then all started laughing. And I'm not saying that's what you're doing because it's not that's what you're doing.
Yeah, I definitely feel that of like, it's, you got nothing left, but you got to do something. That creativity is going to bubble up from somewhere. And
And it came in these super moves. I can't wait to see them. I don't know. I guess you're not consciously doing it, but the whole thing seems to kind of be like a parody tribute to kissing in general and human beings just like finding intimacy in particular. That's how it seems. Is that what's happening?
Maybe. I don't know. I mean, there's this idea of when you're creating a thing, not to wear your critic hat because then you'll tighten up on stuff. So we've been really interested in what many people have projected on it. And
that's one of my favorite things is showing the game to people and kind of what they take away from it varies from person to person, which I think is really cool.
And we have had people be like, oh, that's hot. And I'm like, wow, I would not have thought that. And then we've had other people say, like, aren't you worried for the generation of kids that are going to see this who have never kissed anyone? And I said, no, we're doing them a service because I had braces at that age. And I think getting it all out there, out front, is a lot safer. So,
oh, sure. So. and when I say parody tribute, I really do get a sense that there's like an underlying affection for general in the game, even though you're poking fun at it a little bit. Like anyone who works that hard on a thing for that long, you have to kind of love your subject matter to a degree, I would guess.
Yeah, I'd say we do.
We do, and at moments it's quite horrifying, but we definitely have a lot of affection for this project.
Ah, wonderful. One other thing I forgot to get to, hands, God. God's hands? How many hands does God have? What's God doing in this game?
Again, our artist Miles, who I wish could have been here with us today, things will stick in his head and like never go away and find their way into things. And he just had this vision of this kind of like LA guy from the 70s with the spiritual group. And, you know, kind of, he was like into it. Like, this is the guy who tells you your score and he's going to have a bunch of hands. At one point in time, he was counting your score on his fingers. But now instead, he will be delivering the achievements that you can unlock with those hands. So, which will be.
I mean, I think he's God for some reason, but my memory.
That's cool. No, that's good. He's very, very archetypal white beard guy type god.
He's godness.
I don't know if God wears that kind of a medallion or has that kind of a white denim vest.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe that's your god.
Yeah. We also really love the idea that he's, because he comes up from the bottom. That was just for the purposes of getting him onto the screen, but I kind of like the idea that he's down there watching the whole time.
Yeah.
Which creeps some people out a lot, and it probably should.
But he's inactive. He's not involved. He's just an observer. As the player is observing, like one of the things I like about the game, at least I haven't played it yet, but envisioning playing it, like I both like feel connected to what's happening, and I'm also like observing it. Like, that is not me. I am not Mutton. I am not any of those characters exactly. And they are drawn in a style, I don't know if Miles went for this, where it's like that nice mesh between simple, so you take in the information quickly and know what you're looking at, but still more on the realistic side. So you're like, oh yeah, that if they were all like smiley faces or like anime characters kissing, I would be like, oh, I'm actually supposed to like put myself in the role of the person whose tongue is out right now. But I'm really just watching people do tongue moves while I feel like I'm coaching them. Like,
yeah, I think that's a good place to be at. And I think we've seen that when we've demoed it, that people, some people are like, it's me, but they're rare. The other people are like, who's making out, you know? And, oh, they look like a cute couple. Let's have them make out. And yeah, and I think as for the art style, I mean, Miles came up with that with no direction from us. And he's got a very distinctive style, I think, and it comes from being a kind of outsider to doing digital art and video game art a little bit. He his day job is monktiki.com. He makes ceramic tiki mugs, pays a mortgage making tiki mugs and other ceramic sculptures. And like, here's one just to hold up, a little guy. This is a little monkey character he made. And this one, you'll notice his big headphones and everything was themed after Jet Set Radio, which is one of our favorite games. All three of us as a team have a lot of games we like in common. And that was one focal point. We could try to pan the camera and mess up everything, but I collect a lot of his art, so it's around.
I see some skulls up on a shelf behind you.
Yes, those are definitely Monktiki as well. And he learned how to do some animation in Flash to support his website for his business. And kind of after doing that for a few years, he was like, hey, let's make games. And so it's definitely coming from a different perspective. And his aesthetic is pretty heavily influenced by kind of the lowbrow art scene in general.
Yeah, I mean, I always like to think that his designs are going for something that's, I like to think of it kind of as unlovely. Hmm. That's even a thing. I mean, it's there's a lot going on with the characters. I don't know. That really doesn't describe it very well, though.
He uses the word crude, and I think there is a little bit of a crudeness there, but I think that word is almost too harsh for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not like Beavis and Butthead level. Like, look how gross these people are. Let's laugh at people. But at the same time, it's not like shying away from the fact that I wish I didn't look like this. I wish I looked like a cute anime guy who'd show up with big eyes and like perfect skin. But my nose has got like little dents in it now. And I don't know why this distance is so long. So it's like embracing the imperfection isn't quite right. But the things about our face we probably wish weren't there. He's not shying away from those things. He's putting them right in there. And having people, like, when people say they think it's hot, here's my guess as to why they think it's hot. Because I can have a tiny bit of that's there along with them. Like, it is so nice to make eye contact with somebody and be like, you're not, like, textbook beautiful. I'm not either, but we don't even care. We're just going to embrace this moment together. There's, like, a purity to that. It's getting away from the shallow surface level, like, I'm only kissing you because you look like Elle McPherson or some other hot model of the day. It's because, like, I'm really into you as a person. Like, you wouldn't do that unless you really like them. These people seem to really like each other. Mutton kissing the guy who looks a little bit, I think there's a guy who reminded me anyway of the dude from the film Big Lebowski. Mutton and him are so into each other.
Yeah,
they are. And that's a good entree to say that, like, two things. One, when you have 20 characters, if they all were the same, but just with like different hair and eye color, that would be really boring. And then second, like, yeah, it's no shock that he looks a little like the dude. And some of our characters look a little like someone or some reference. And it all comes from something that we're engaged with. Like, you might look at the character Bobby and say, like, wow, that looks a little bit like Bob from Twin Peaks. Who would want to make out with him? But, you know, if you pair him up with Laverne, they're going to go to town. Yeah, so.
Oh, wow. I didn't see Bobby yet. I'm going to keep an eye out for Bobby now. Very exciting. So Miles, was it Miles's idea then for you guys to get into game development together?
Originally, yeah. He, Chris had been working on, I'll let Chris speak to what he was working on, but.
I was doing a lot of contract work I did Flash advert gaming for years, you know, like the terrible, terrible Flash video games that different companies would use to promote their products.
They weren't all terrible.
I think if they weren't terrible, it's because we had to really work at making them more than terrible, because I think a lot of people commissioning games for websites at the time were not really looking for quality, I guess. Mm-hmm. You know, so they were mostly just an opportunity for product placement. You know, so it was a lot of, you know, make sure this logo is 20% larger and directly in the center of the screen. You know,
At all times
kind of things.
That has no impact on gameplay.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. But, so you have that directive, and that's relatively profitable, I hope, because it's for, like, anything that robs you of any chance of getting to be creative, it's got to pay. I hope so.
Yeah, it was a pretty decent pay. And I mean,
its heyday has passed.
Yeah.
I've seen that. Absolutely.
Yeah, Flash games. Go ahead. Thank you. Flash games kind of, I don't know, they're still around. I keep getting, every time I say this, somebody says, no, there's tons of Flash games at Newgrounds and at Kongregate. But I think that kind of the age of the web, like the web-based Flash game for businesses, is pretty much gone.
Sure.
It's not anywhere where it is. Now somebody does an app if they want something like that. So,
right. Yeah. There's many apps now.
Yeah. And this was before the iPhone was even a thing. And I remember even talking to my coworkers at the time about the iPhone, and they were like, oh, please, we don't have time to think about things like that. So, you know,
really? Going to play games on their phone.
Yeah, games on your phone. That's just a flash in the pan. That'll never survive. So,
here we are. And did your skills working on Flash games for companies translate into what you were able to do with Smooth Operator and the games you worked on with Miles when he first started?
I think so. One thing that it did is it really, for one thing, it helped me learn how to program games to begin with, because I had no experience prior to that. And then it also helped me understand kind of the workflow of how to produce a game and work with an artist, because I worked with a lot of artists as part of that job. When I decided to leave, it's because I wanted to try and make things that, I had all kinds of game ideas, just bottomless pit of game ideas, and I wanted to make some of those game ideas, because if you try to pitch one of those ideas to one of the companies we were working for, it's just that they're just like, yeah, okay, sure, right, I'll just make another racing game that's exactly like the 20 previous ones we've contracted you guys to make.
Sure.
Toy manufacturers tend to shy away from ideas about being a dung beetle rolling up the sun.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
But I've said this God knows how many times. Poor frequent listeners of this show, they must be so ready for a new guest, because I say this like every week. But it's always on my mind when I'm talking to folks for the first time who have been in this spot where like creativity wasn't what their employers wanted from them. They like wanted you to be able to craft something per their design that was going to follow their plan to make money. And that was as creative as it got. But if you look at what actually makes tons of money, it's weird ideas. That's where profit ends up happening. If you don't take that risk, you'll never get there. If you just follow the crowd, you're only going to do a diminished version of whatever the crowd made for money. You're never going to be that big new thing on the scene that everyone's talking about, because it's you're always going to remind somebody something else. I wish they understood that. If they did, Smooth Operator would be, you know, the next Angry Birds marketed sensation. And maybe it still will be. It's coming out in February, right?
Yeah, it's coming out on February 11th, so just in time for Valentine's Day. So. Aww. We had to anchor to something, right? And we're cheap. We'll take any seasonal coverage we can get.
But to continue the autobiographical story of Beardo Games. So Beardo Games was formed when the three of you all got together, or was it
It was originally Miles. You know, we hang out a lot. He's based out of Portland too. We've known him through his artwork for years and years and all been friends. And the genesis of Beardo Games was really a game called To Go Beard, which was about having food in your beard, like a to-go box from the restaurant. And because Miles has a beard that would put Chris's to shame.
Beard. That must be a heck of a beard.
It's
monumental.
It's got gravitas.
Yes. It's got presence in a room.
Yeah.
In addition to his own presence. So.
And so there was no kind of gameplay mechanic. There was no real understanding how to play it. There were some vague ideas. There was a lot of artwork generated, and it was then a springboard into some other things. And we really hit our stride as a team by doing jam games and really working out how we work together and what in our process is strong that we can capitalize on. And certainly the weird ideas and the creativity is one of those things. And just, you know, learning how to edit ourselves and like what's the best of what we're doing. Okay, you had 1,000 ideas. We can't make all of them. Which one will we have the best energy working on? And so for the last little while, that's been smooth off. We've been able to keep the energy strong and positive on that. Even though at the end of, like, I'm sure everyone who's ever made anything says, I can't wait for this to be done so I can work on something else. But it's been good.
Yeah,
sounds it. It sounds like the form that a comedy troupe often takes. They're like, what are you going to be? Are you going to be the best straight man? Or are you going to be the best like physical comedy guy? Are you going to be like the character actor? You don't know at first because everyone likes to do a little bit of everything. And then over a few years, people end up falling into their roles that they're strongest at. Was that how it was for you? Did you all have kind of like Miles sounds like pretty clearly he was the artist at first. But Kate and Chris, did you have your places right away? And if they stayed where they were originally, or has it evolved?
For me, it's mostly stayed this. Well, it's evolved a little bit in that I did a little bit of art prior to really hitting our stride. But Miles right now is entirely doing the art, and gotcha. I'm entirely doing the programming. Mm. And then I'll let Kate talk about her role.
I think my role has probably changed the most, where I talk about having that kind of editorial eye and saying like, what's good about this thing and what's going down the rabbit hole? Because when you have kind of a ton of creativity, you can take something that could be a mobile game that you play for 30 seconds here and there on your phone and keep tacking ideas on and tacking ideas on. And all of a sudden it's like Grand Theft Auto and it's got the sandbox world and it's got all these multiple complex objectives. And I'm like, this was a little, you know, tapping game on your phone where you're supposed to punch a guy. Why does it need to be all that? And so my role, you know, in that kind of producer editor has kind of grown over time. And I just try not to be too much stepping on anyone's toes, but to keep stuff moving too.
Yeah,
the editor, from where I stand anyway, a good editor anyway, finds the process of finding what's good and extrapolating on that while still shaving away the stuff that maybe muddies the picture or is better off saved for another project or something. So editors aren't always just like banging the gavel and saying, bad idea, you're guilty, you suck at everything. They're also like saying, great idea, let's build on that too. And I get a lot of that from you already, Kate, just knowing that we're at least 45 minutes or so. So what the first project was To Go Beard.
And it never really got off the ground.
We want to figure out what it even is and revisit it.
Well, and I've got a dozen ideas for it that I think probably would work,
But that's the problem. A dozen ideas, and maybe they're good, maybe they're not. Maybe we need a dozen more. Maybe we need 100 ideas to choose from, and then we need to like go to the beach and not think about them and regroup and choose the best one.
Well, what a challenge. to like take a concept like I'm gonna eat food out of a beard. What do you draw upon? Like, oh yeah, we'll just reference all the other eating food out of a beard games, and like there's nothing. And the same with a smooth operator. There are not a ton of kissing games or even like physical interact with somebody else in a pleasurable way, like massage games or whatever. There's very, very few of them. I'm thinking, I know there's a DS game in Japan where you just like towel basketball boys. Like that.
I can't think of the name of it though.
But it wasn't like super good or anything. It's not like you draw mats for like, we're going to somehow outdo the towel basketball boys game. Like that's not what you were hoping for. So your ideas in general, I don't want to, there's so much I want to talk to you about. I don't know. But before I get ahead of myself, I want to make sure I ask, like, were there influences that you had for any of your games, or did they really just spring out of nowhere?
I think the biggest first one for Smooth Op back from the beginning was Street Fighter, just because of the 2D facing off quality of it, and that definitely led to the evolution of the super moves. I think it would be unfair not to mention that there has been a really noteworthy two-player profile kissing game that's been around the last year or so, Realistic Kissing Simulator. It's very different. It's more playful without scoring objectives and things like that, but it's two aliens. So we like that. There was also a few years ago a like battling kissing unicorns game that I think was an Adult Swim game.
I think so. Yeah.
So there's some examples, but our mechanics are nothing like any of them. So it's been, that's been our biggest struggle on this game is like, how do you even play the thing, and how do we make it fun, and how do we make it use the touch screen since we're bringing it to mobile?
Right, and I wanted to mention Alien Makeout Simulator. I don't know if you played that one. Very different than your game.
Is that the VR one?
Yeah, so you've got to like aim your actual lips at a alien's lips. It's got all these different mouths and stuff. So yeah, people want kissing games. You're onto something. But in 2013, there wasn't like we can go through our backlog of successful kissing games to draw.
Yeah, it's not a deep bench. It's not a deep bench.
Well, no, we should also mention that there are a fair number of mobile kissing games on the mobile market that are
Google Play. If you like search kissing games, there's like stuff that has just millions of downloads, but they're typically two characters, like a boy and the girl, and they have to like smooch when the angry dad isn't looking. So they're coming from a very different place than we are. I hesitate to use the term shovelware, but I just did.
I mean, it
feels a little bit like on the lines of Elsa Cesarean Simulator. In terms of
is that the one where the frozen lady needs pregnancy help? Yeah.
But this some of these games that are kind of churned out, not necessarily coming from the same kind of place that we are with, you know. I don't know. Now I sound incredibly condescending.
No, you don't. You do sound, though. I'm curious. You sound like someone who never like wants to be mean, and that's nice. Isn't that nice to not want to be mean? You're pretty. Oh yeah. And has there ever been meanness in any of your games? Is there any like? Does anyone ever get hurt?
Yeah. Totally. There was a project called Cheap Shot that we're still on the hook to make that was about being frustrated in a crowd and sucker punching people.
When
they're not looking and not getting caught. And like I said, we are on the hook to make that eventually. We have to go back to the drawing board and figure out how to make it fun. But that was a very Miles-led idea about, you know, because we're interested in evoking some kind of emotional response. And his emotional response was like, I'm surrounded by people getting off this airplane, you know, and he never would hit anyone. He's a completely sweet, gentle guy. But just that kind of feeling of let me get out of here. And so we will end up doing some games with little violence, with a little, you know, more energy.
Yeah, but it doesn't sound it's power fantasy violence, but not in the I'm all powerful sort of way. Like, not the buying into any archetypes. It's kind of like admitting, and this, I'm trying to like analyze all your games while I forgive me when I'm going to get it all wrong. But the running theme seems to be like, there's a thing about you that you may not be super psyched about. Like, you don't love this about you. When you stick your tongue into somebody else's mouth, part of you is thinking like, am I really doing this? Why am I doing this? Even though it's fun. So like, let's look at those parts, admit that they're there, and like glorify them a little bit and be like, you're not a bad person because you want to rub your tongue against that tongue. It's gross, but it's not gross. It's also awesome. Sometimes you're going to want to punch a guy. That's okay. That is, you are a human being with an amygdala and a hippocampus. They make you feel like punching somebody sometimes. Here's a safe way to play around with that feeling without actually hitting anybody and admitting like, yeah, we're animals and we're people at the same time. And that's okay. Let's laugh about it. Let's have fun with it. That seems to be a theme. Like, when I've got food in my beard, I am thinking like, I am a disgusting animal, kind of. But it's also kind of funny. And is there any harm in it? Not really. No. So let me eat that corn or whatever.
Oh, yeah, gross. I do appreciate that. I do think that is a fair analysis.
I agree.
You know, there is a very human side to Beardo Games.
Huh. And where did the name come from? Was it just because you both had giant beards?
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much it. There's nothing yes, exciting about it.
Me personally.
Well, yeah.
It's a little different now, but
Kate,
no.
Kate has a spiritual beard. Internal beard, you know. So.
Yeah, she carries with her.
I like my scarves.
I never even thought of that. It does kind of convey a beard feeling.
But still, yeah, it was Miles kind of designed the logo and said, how about this? And we were both like, yeah, it's strong. Let's just do that. Yeah. It sounds cool. Beardo. Got two Beardo weirdos on the team. Let's just do it.
Well, I was going to say, Beardo sometimes means a weird bearded person. Person with a weird beard or a weird person with a beard.
And we got weird people with beards for days.
The fact that you were able to just grab onto a name like that and run with it, no small feat. A lot of developers tell me they're trying to come up with their studio name. They know they're going to be stuck with it for like maybe forever. Gaijin Games changed their name to Totally Choice because they hated their name after a few years. That's a little strong. Maybe, I don't know if they hated it, but they said whatever they felt for it was strong enough that they felt like they needed to completely change the name. So it's, but that was after they like grew and became like, I think they've got like 30 or so people in their studio now. They started off as just three people, such as you did. So do you think it was the fact that you were small and able to just run without having to worry too much about whether it was going to like make or break you financially forever? You were able to just kind of spring with creativity like that.
I think so. And I think since we were coming from a place of just being playful and having fun, yeah, we didn't view this as like, oh my God, is someday a venture capital person going to hate this name? Because it just will, nothing was further from our minds. And I'll tell you a kind of secret, not secret. Chris and Miles both have Beardo tattoos now with the company logo.
Cool. So you're married to that. That's not going anywhere.
Yeah. Well, I hear they do great things with lasers these days, but.
True. The future is coming. Who knows? For some reason, I suddenly want to talk about beards some more. Tell me if you're sick of it. I was trying to figure out, like, what is the fashion kind of benchmark or touchstone for 2015 or these 2010 years we're in. Like, used to be afros and bell bottoms, and then in the 80s, it was like gel in your hair and zippers all over your jacket, and then the 90s was flannel shirts and Neil Young. Like, the fact that the singer for Pearl Jam wanted to kiss Neil Young really bad is like part of the 90s. I don't know if you knew that. You may want
to. Does that mean we need Eddie Vedder in our game so that he can make out with Mutton? I mean,
just get him on the phone.
Sure, Eddie. Eddie would love it. He would love it. Then 2015, what's even fashion? I don't even know. Is it beards?
Like I don't know. I feel like it's super complicated because I feel like, especially out here on the West Coast, I mean, I could walk down the street and I could be like, hey, look, it's 1983, but it's also 1972, but it's also 1962, and it's also 1995. And it's, I feel like it's probably in a way more diverse than it's ever been. And because nothing ever goes away, and then things come back in varying degrees. I think in the Pacific Northwest lumberjack culture, the beard is kind of timeless.
Before I ever grew my beard, there were plenty of people I knew in Portland who would grow a beard in winter and just shave it as soon as it got warmer. Year after year after year.
Winter face warmer.
Yeah.
But, like the scarves.
But I think Portland's also a pretty weird example of trying to tell what's in fashion, because there's an amazingly incredible aesthetic culture here. There's people we know who dress like it's the 50s every single day. You know, and their kitchen is a 1950s kitchen with all the pots and pans with the toxic chemicals in them, you know. So,
but they look so good.
But they look beautiful, and they're amazingly attentive to their fashion, you know. But it's something that's just very specifically their thing.
People aren't splitting off into like fashion cliques in the same way either, is from what I'm gathering. Everything is like an extension of who you are, but it doesn't mean you can only hang out with people who are also 1950s toxic pot folks.
I think it can be pretty eclectic, yeah, and pretty open. I'm sure out there there's, you know, some like, well, I'm a prairie homesteader and all my friends are prairie homesteaders, yeah, and that's all we're going to do in our sod houses. But I think it's pretty eclectic.
Yeah.
I'm so glad you don't actually know that prairie homesteader only person, because they're in their prairie homestead alone,
and they don't have an iPad, so they're definitely not in our demographic for any of our games. So,
were there? You mentioned Street Fighter. Is that a game that you guys grew up with? Is that a So
definitely.
It wasn't that long ago. I feel like it wasn't that long. Now that I think about it, it was almost 2 years ago. Nina Freeman, who recently made a game called Sabile, it's a super neat game.
Also from Portland. She's in Portland now.
I didn't know. Oh, yeah. She's with, she's working on Tacoma now.
With Fulbright. Portland has a really vibrant indie scene, and it's great. And shout outs to Pig Squad, Portland Indie Game Squad. Holla. Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm a total dork. I'm like, see, I'm cool. I can say the things like the kids.
You sure can. You can holler with the best of them.
And that is going to be heavily sampled into a track into the game now.
Yeah, exactly.
You saying holla? I'd love that.
No, you saying you can holler with the best of them.
Oh, I don't know.
Over and over and over again. I mean,
you were just told by a 38-year-old man that you're cool, so take that with a grain of salt. I'm way past my prime myself. So,
how long is this podcast?
No,
honestly, we're actually thrilled to be on with you, because I was just reading an article of yours last week that was all about nipples.
Nipple one. I say this again. I say this a lot on the show too, so I'm saying it again. I like accidentally make people mad sometimes. I always feel super bad about it. People read that nipples wand post, and some thought the last paragraph was super funny, and other people were like, "You're affecting me personally. You like offended me as an individual with that." I'm like, "I don't even know you. How did I?" It's just a silly post about nipples wand. But anyway, there you have it. You can't help it sometimes, as you guys have seen with what you're working on. People, you can't control what kind of emotional reaction you're going to get.
It's true.
It's definitely true. We've showed it off at a couple different places, and we've really, I guess it was at Retro Gaming Expo here in Portland last year.
Ran away. Like, nope, gross, gone. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I wanted a chance to apologize. It was like, I'm sorry, I didn't think it was, I knew it was weird, I didn't think it was that scary, but.
And we get a lot of, we get a lot of kind of that surreptitious, oh, this is disgusting, I'll be back in 5 minutes with 10 of my friends.
Yeah, that's so true too. There's kind of the, I hate you. Hey everyone, come look at this thing. Yeah. So, yeah.
Huh, interesting. I wonder, have any of the criticisms like really stung? Have any of them been hurtful?
Well, there was a while when Miles's dad hated it.
Oh, really?
And that was a little like, oh, come on. And I think he just eventually got desensitized to it, and he's all good now.
Yeah, he loves it now.
He wore him down. He was just like, I feel nothing when I see it, so it's fine. You know, the more you see it.
That's one of the best ways of dealing with disapproving parents is to just bore them into submission. Yeah, exactly. Finally, fine, fine. I like it.
I'm done hearing about it. No more.
and positive things. Have there been surprises? You mentioned before that people were like genuinely aroused by it. But were there any other compliments that either surprised you or genuinely touched you in some way?
One of my favorites was, and I don't know if it touched me, but it was like such a strong response. I remember it. It sticks out in my mind that there is a character in the game named Grace who's inspired by Jet Set Radio. So she has great big headphones on. And we met a guy who swore she was Rihanna. And we were like, oh, I don't really think she looks like Rihanna. And he was like, no, that is Rihanna. And why aren't all the other characters in the game Rihanna? And I want to play your game for Rihanna. And call me when this is out and I'll buy it and make all my friends buy it because I love Rihanna. And I was like, okay, that's good. But it was he was very emotional about kissing Rihanna.
And Rihanna kissing Rihanna, it sounds like.
Exactly. That's really what he wanted.
Implicitly. Yeah. Implicitly. Would be involved,
all the Rihannas. Yeah. All 20 of them.
But we get a lot of the thing that I'm really socially awkward, so I'm bad at showing the game. So it's
you're great. Awful. You're doing so good on this live show with Stranger. If you can do this, you can do anything. I think. Anyway.
Well, let's not talk about it too much. I love it. I really love it when we have return customers, when we'll show it at an expo or a con or something, and we'll have people just bring other people back, like drag them over to see it. And that just is really rewarding for me. So I feel like we're hitting those people just the right way.
Oh, good. Yeah. I'm guessing a lot of people are going to have like morbid curiosity. And it seems so perfect for where internet culture seems to be at right now. I don't know, I doubt you guys planned this, especially given that the game looked more or less, the prototype from Ludum Dare was not all that dissimilar from how it looks now anyway, so it was 2 years ago. But yeah, you're right at this point where people like want niceness, but they're not quite ready to say it. They wanna be like edgy and aloof a little bit and like laughing at people still, because this is internet culture. Yeah. They feel like safe when they point and laugh at somebody else. I've seen it with Bob Ross on Twitch.
Oh yeah,
he's like suddenly super popular. And I would, not to brag, but I put Bob Ross in a show that we did in February, so it was like ahead of the curve. Nice. Nobody liked it, but now people like Bob Ross. So, it's too early, I guess. But anyway, yeah, they like point and laugh. Look at this corny guy. He's so sweet. It's like he'd never make it in today's edgy internet world. Oh, wait a minute, I love him, and I'm gonna watch this for like 8 hours and just actually feel good. So like, your game is essentially being nice to somebody, like kissing. Because it's nice.
Yeah, it might just be a little too icky to actually hit that until you're desensitized to it.
Exactly.
If you see it enough, then it's like, it no longer shocks me. Let's just play a co-op kissing game with our fingers.
And when you're actually playing it, like you're saying, not only do you get desensitized to the concepts and the style, then you also laugh when the super moves happen. But if you're getting to touch someone who you like, while like laughing, like, haha, isn't this funny? Mm-hmm. Kissing, isn't it gross? I like you.
Yeah.
Like, is the unspoken thing. It's kind of perfect for where internet's at right now. I
would like that to be the case. Like, yeah, too. Very much.
I guess we'll find out soon enough. Well, where else could we go from here talking?
Well, you started talking about Street Fighter.
Oh, right, I did. And I lost track. So what is it about Street Fighter? Because it's a game about interacting with another person, but it's purely violence-based. And this is something Nina Freeman and I talked about a while ago, is that Smash Brothers is kind of a sex analogy for me, because you're getting somebody else's percentages up and you're like, juggling them a bit. And then all of a sudden, they max out and go flying and explode and sparkles and stars. Like, that's all I can take. Oh! And then they come right back and are like, no, I'm going to do it to you. It's sort of sweet in that way. I don't think that's what they were going for, but that may be why it resonates with some people on some level, or not. Who knows? But yeah, fighting games. to make them not about fighting, to make them instead about something else. Not an easy thing to take on, I don't think, but he did it.
Well, it's been a really rocky road because, like I said earlier, we really originally had this concept of like using the positioning of the tongues as, you know, like your six attacks, or in our case, nine attacks in Street Fighter. Sure. It just, we found out pretty quickly that it doesn't map that way at all.
Mm-hmm. And it's not well tuned to a, you know, touchscreen, to mobile device. Yeah. You know what I mean? The same way, like all of our conventions around how you engage, how you interface with that true fighting game framework is not that easily. I'm sure someone's going to put in the comments like, well, here are a million games that do it well for a mobile device. And I'm like, well, I no longer have time to play games. I'm sorry.
Don't say that.
But one of the things that's always drawn me, you know, from back from being a kid and everything to fighting games was the characters and being, it's the gameplay is super fun. It's super fun to master all the moves and know how to really work a particular character. But just that idea of how it feels when you engage those games the first time and you start scrolling through and you're like, oh my God, this one, this one, this one, this guy, this guy, this guy, this gal. Look at that, look at that one, look at that one, look at his cape, look at her boots, you know, and that kind of like having lots of choices. I just really like the feeling of that. And I think that's something that even though the game has become really different from a fighting game, that scrolling through all the characters to choose feeling, I think sticks.
Yeah, yeah. That was definitely designed with fighting game, calling out a fighting game type select screen in mind. Because I know I think it shows in the video that you've watched, but you can select on each side of the screen just by swiping through, and they do like a cover flow style scroll, you know, where the one in the back comes to the front, or you know, slowly to the front. And I'm totally over explaining this.
No, you're doing good. And it gave me an 80s, 90s album cover feeling a little bit too. Like I felt like I was scrolling through albums, being like, which one am I gonna like choose to get to know today? Who knows which one's gonna be?
Do I like LL Cool J or do I like Vanilla Ice? Or do I like the Bee Gees or
And it speaks to something we all want to do. We all want to get to know other people, even folks who say, "Oh, I'm antisocial. I don't actually want to get in there." There's always an instinct to like find out what somebody else is actually like, and it allows you to do that in a way that's very direct, though. You I'm still laughing about your game. So you pick your face, you're facing off against somebody else, you handshake with them in the loading screen, maybe that's them, but you're getting like, okay, we're just getting warmed up. We're going to like feel each other out through this bizarre handshake, and then just straight into tongue on tongue kissing for a while.
You do get to choose where you're going to make out kind of in between the two things. You know, and the places you make out are super normal, like the laundromat or, of course, the arcade.
It looks like there's a crowd behind them sometimes.
The heavy metal show is definitely one of the stages. And that's the one where the super move is the air guitar. So,
So are the super moves stage dependent sometimes?
Yes,
they're entirely stage dependent.
Oh, and that is why the weirdest one is the pet store.
February can't come soon enough. Have you decided how you're going to go about selling it?
It's complicated. Yeah. I mean, we definitely live in a free-to-play world, but at the same time, like I talk about us all having good energy for the project that keeps us sustained and keeps us going, but when we start this is going to sound really naive and snotty, but when we start thinking about like, well, do we make this, you know, DLC? Do we make this, you know, 99 cents to unlock all these characters or these stages? Or do we put ads everywhere in the game? We really lose that energy and that positive energy. And since we didn't design it from the get-go as a free-to-play game, we think we'd rather just put a little small fee on it. Make it premium, and it is what it is, and we'll learn how that goes, and maybe you know, a year from now we'll be telling you about our game that's loaded with ads and microtransactions, but that's where we're at right now.
Which I hope not. I mean, there's I hate to say not that there's anything wrong with that, but it's the best phrase I can think of to describe microtransactions and ads. I just feel like they work. I just don't think they work in this game. So it's just going to be a relatively cheap premium.
Because like I said, one of the things I love about the game and showing it to someone for the first time is having that open up to that character screen. And it's like, look, there's 20 unique characters and two crossovers, and you can scroll through all of them and match them up however you want. And you really lose that feeling if half of them are locked, and or more than half of them. Right? It's like, you start with these two and pay me if you want to say more. So it just feels like the feeling of the game is better as a premium game.
Sure. And that's your priority, it sounds like, which works. I think it's very hard to make a microtransactions game that feels good, like, at all. There's a couple. I don't know if you played Rusty's Real Deal Baseball.
Not yet, but I have heard of that.
Yeah, I've
and
heard
then,
of
it. Well, I mean, there's a couple. I mean, like, Crossy Road is the bazillion dollar example of where you can engage it can be fun, and you can spend no money if you don't want to, but some people get really into it and spend a bunch, and there's ads and things like that, and it works pretty well. And there's one that I'm really hooked on that I don't know if you've seen. It's been kind of everywhere on Twitter, the Alpha Bears.
I've seen it.
Yeah, sometimes the Alpha Bears can say some naughty things depending on what words you build in the word game. But it has some, microtransaction stuff that I think was well designed and not icky.
Tastefully handled.
Yeah.
And I think those work better for games that you don't feel like you're necessarily getting to know the developers directly through them. Like Crossy Road, beautiful aesthetic, but it is so robot. It is so clean. Alpha Bears is just like, very cute design, but it's there's nothing about it that's got like that human touch to it. Unlike your games, which are like, you feel like you are rubbing a beard when you're playing them. It's getting to know everything in there. I haven't played them, but from what I feel from them so far, that's the sense I get. So I don't know if microtransactions, like if you make people aware, like, oh, we are people and we want your money, that immediately like sends a fight or flight response into people. Like, I'm afraid of you. You're going to somehow rob me and I'm going to run away. Whereas when it's like a cartoon bear being like, how about a little dough? They'll be like, cartoon bear, you're nothing to be afraid of. Here's 20 cents. What's the big deal?
I think the best example of that from recently is the new 3DS badge game by Nintendo.
I've been playing the heck out of that game. I haven't spent a dime on it yet. I've got 55 badges, have not spent a cent, but I may someday. Just for if I have an extra dollar and it's fun enough, I might do it.
I think another good example is a game that's getting a second life now that it's translated into English, the Neko Atsume.
Yeah, that's the little cats.
And you don't have to spend any money on it, but eventually if you play with it long enough, you're like, I really want to make these kitties happy, and if I just drop $3.99 to get some more goldfishes to buy them this cat condo, I'll make my kitties happy.
Well, and also spending money on something like that is kind of the opposite, where I'm looking at it and I'm thinking to myself, this thing is completely free. It has ridiculously unobtrusive ads that you actually have to click through to find. They're hard to find in the game. So I want this person making this game to make more games. So I want to spend a little bit of money on it. But that's really, really rare, I think.
Well, I feel like that would work for you guys, potentially. Maybe not with ads. Depending on the ads. Like, ads can just be fun, too. If you got like the Undertale guy to like put ads in your game,
that would be amazing. Yeah, it'd be fun.
So you never know with an ad.
Yeah, and it's curating it. Like, I pictured this worst case scenario where it's like we just have exclusively porn ads in the game because some keywords get crosswired, and I'm like, well, don't know how I feel about that. But
that's exactly what I was thinking too. Is that even websites? I'm always like, why am I getting toenail fungus ads on this website?
I don't want toenail fungus ads.
I just wonder how much of that actually gets curated, because I see that kind of stuff on websites where it just doesn't seem to match.
Well, and we're showing our ignorance. It's a whole science and an art. Yeah. There are people who really, that's their bread and butter, and they know. So
Well, they may not be buttering their bread that well if poor Chris is getting toe fungus ads. you know, he should be getting like ads related to things he already likes. So, I mean, that's the only time advertising I think works is when you enjoy it and like want to identify with the product and therefore go buy it after you see the ad. So I can see like a really good Skittles ad working in your game. Like a super good one. And I can see a Skittles ad just being your game. Like, Skittles coming out and exchanging Skittles between tongues.
Skittles everywhere. And
I would want to eat Skittles after that, for sure.
And like the fist bump happens and Skittles fly out.
That'd be so good. We have to get Skittles on the phone. We just solve all your money problems forever.
Exactly.
The other thing I was going to mention, though, is I wish that mobile, and maybe it does, and I don't know it, but I wish mobile had a pay what you want option. Because like that Rihanna guy, he would be so happy with you that he would just be like, here's $1,000. I'm the Rihanna's biggest fan and I've got disposable income. Thank you for making the Rihanna game. Like people are going to like you guys when they play your game. Not everyone's going to get it, but the people who get it are going to feel like, I can't get this anywhere else and this makes me feel really special. I want to make these people happy. They could look at an ad or they could just give you $10. We saw that happen with Jane Friedman, who made Slam City Oracles. She would get like $100 out of nowhere from a stranger, not from her mom or whatever. She didn't pay what you what you want, and a lot of people just bought it for free, but it made up for it with the people who decided to pay her because they really identified with what she did. So I wonder if there's a way to do that. Would there ever be a PC version, or is it definitely mobile forever?
The problem with doing a PC version is that so relatively few PCs have touchscreen right now, and we've really gone all in on the swiping mechanics. We've done some brainstorming around, okay, it's got to be this awkward thing where your hands are getting together and getting in each other's way a little bit. So we thought maybe there was like a keyboard version where it's like telling me to hit J while it's telling you to hit W, and now we have to both hit, you know, Z and A and S and D at the same time in rapid succession. You know what I mean? Like trying to transform that experiential part to it. So there are some thoughts there for how it could go PC, but it's complicated.
I think on some level that would be a different game almost.
Actually, in a way, we already made.
That's true.
Did a jam game about hypnotizing people for another Ludum Dare, that it was an unconventional weapon. And you hit keys on the keyboard to swing the amulet back and forth to hypnotize the guy who's trying to rob you. And the what key you have to hit keeps changing. So you're like, you know, A-L-A-L. Oh, no, now it's S-K-S-K. And it's really hard. I'm not good at it.
That sounds really fun, though. It sounds like it. I love a game that makes me feel like I've got it all figured out. So I get this high of confidence, but also boredom is starting to leak in at that point because I'm like, I've got this on lock. No big deal. Whoa, now I have to do this. And then I get to start over mentally and redo the challenge. Sounds good. What's the hypnotism?
Yeah, it's called Mystic Stick Up. And it is on our website. That one is definitely playable on our website. And that's the same jam that we did the Intergalactic Boy Band Conquest for, the unconventional weapon.
You hinted at that before the show started, and I'm so glad you found a way to segue into it. What is Intergalactic Boy Band? What the heck?
Basically, it was the same. It was the same jam, same Ludum Dare. I think it was back in spring. The theme was unconventional weapon, and when we did our curated brainstorming, we had about 200 ideas on the sheet. And I mean, because like when I say we have to like really brainstorm it out and avoid the initial impulse, we really brainstorm it out. And we started doing Mystic Stick Up, the hypnotism game of how do you do hypnotism as a weapon, but it's a weapon of self-defense. And my role on that was pretty much done in like 2 or 3 hours on the Friday night of the weekend of the jam. And so it was kind of like, okay, let's make another game. And Twine is a really simple tool if you want to make a game that depends on choices in a hurry. And so I did a game where you are kidnapped by aliens and they make you help them build a boy band that will induce a global swoon so they can take over the world. So the boy band is the unconventional weapon.
Whoa, used by aliens.
Used by aliens.
And swoon, of course, that was the word several video games. I think Pokemon, maybe.
You do swoon, yeah.
As opposed to dying, you're just like, oh, still my beating heart. Oh, so happy. All over. So you make the Earth swoon. Is there a fail state?
There's pretty much three general outcomes you can get. You can do a bad design and the aliens make you choose between dying and starting over and trying again. Or you can design one that the aliens think is good enough and they take over the Earth. Or you can do one so good that the aliens themselves swoon and you save humanity by designing such a cute boy band.
Whoa. And that's not an outcome that the game, it sounds like, hints to you that you're going to be able to do. The aliens are the ones telling you, make this boy band.
But and if then you if you just make it so good, you beat them. Yeah.
Did you see the Rick and Morty episode with the giant alien head that says, show me what you've got?
No.
Is it season two?
It is season two. Oh.
See, we've only seen season one. I haven't seen season two yet. It's on my list.
It might be a little bit better. Yeah.
Okay.
It's pretty interesting stuff. Also getting to similar to, what's it called? Cheap Shot? Was that the name?
Yeah.
There's a lot of that in Rick and Morty this past season. There. It's like, you're going to be aggressive and angry sometimes. Don't hate that about yourself. Embrace it. If you fight it, it's only going to get worse. Similarities, which comes to the thing I was thinking. And there may be nothing to say about this, but I'm spitting it out anyway. Like, I feel like Adult Swim should have already called you and been like, here's your $1 million. we're making all your games. Like, if money is a question, have they called you already? It's such a perfect fit.
Unfortunately, we squandered our shot at Adult Swim like a year ago when we had a really crappy build of the game that they were like, we like your stuff, there's just not enough there. And we were like, okay, we believe you. And we, you know, kept working on it. And but yeah, they said they liked the stuff, but like I said, they played like a really sad, dreary, broken build of the game. And it's changed a lot since then. But it was good to get, it was a critical time to get that kind of feedback on what we were doing and get stronger. So, but
I don't know if it's all over, though. I mean, you would know better than me. I know Adult Swim people, kind of. I haven't seen them in a little while. They were, you know, emailing me saying, we've got this video game, please write about it. But they also seem to, like, actually kind of like me as a person. A little bit of interpersonal humanity there. So, I don't know. You never know how they'll take to it once it's out. Once it's out, they may say, we're going to help you make the PC version. There are a lot of different ways. Like Chris was saying, it would have to be a different game. But there's a lot of ways to take that mechanic and make it work for computers, even for consoles. Did I just dream it? Or was there a Wii? No, I didn't dream it. Bumpy's Party. Spin the Bottle Bumpy's Party for the Wii U. I don't know if you've played that. It's all about making people have to like get close to each other. And it's got cute graphics. There's like nothing sexual about it other than the name Spin the Bottle in the United States. Anyway, there's a connotation of like kissing might happen. But you have to like make your Wii remotes touch in just such a way while you play it and like swirl them around, and it's all gyro controlled on the screen.
Your hands doing this looked very evocative. It was lovely.
Yeah.
How kind of you. So there's always ways it can happen, but it's of course going to be up to you whether you're going to work on Smooth Operator for another 2 years, or whether there's like other stuff you've been wanting to do.
There's definitely a lot in the pipeline. I mean, like, Nintendo, call us. You know, you got the. We have a lot of ideas. It kind of depends on the energy after launch. You know, if it comes out for Valentine's Day and people were like, huh, okay, and you know, five people download it and that's that, we'll definitely work on different stuff. Maybe put that on the shelf for a minute. We do have a sequel for we do have a title for the sequel already though.
Smoother Operator.
Smoother Operator.
if that comes to pass.
If it comes to pass.
And then comes to computers, there's already a Steam game called Smooth Operator. I don't know if you knew.
About a call center?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. We actually, way back a couple years ago, we actually emailed that guy and said, hey, do you have any problem with us using the same name as you? And he said, your game is so different and it's for mobile. Go for it.
Sure. So we'd probably have to talk.
We would massage the title.
And it is smooth. It's Smooth Operators.
Oh, I'm saying.
It's what his is.
But
yeah.
But still, I would want to talk with him.
Yeah, because we would not want to.
Yeah.
Infringe.
Or just people looking for your game, finding his game, thinking, oh no, that's not the game I wanted. I'm never looking again. I give up forever.
And I saw tongues. It freaked me out. I thought I was going to see a call center.
would not buy 1 out of 10.
Yeah. You know?
I could see that Steam review happening right away. You know, too many tongues, hated it. It's not even your game. It's his game. were there other games? Two questions. We're almost out of time, but things I always want to. Because as game developers, I feel like I didn't ask you enough questions. Gosh darn, because I want to know more about what your influences were. And also, if we talk about the influences and run out of time, that's fine. But if we can continue after that, we have more time. I'd also want to know like what your dream franchise to work on would be. Ooh. Like, would you want to take Street Fighter and make Guile and Ryu make out? Is that a dream? I don't know. We can start anywhere you want. I'm just throwing out. They're not even questions. They're just conversation starters. Yes.
My favorite franchise of all time is Resident Evil. But I've really enjoyed this Revelations, you know, which is kind of more going the retro. And I think some of the storytelling in that environment and going back to a game where in really old school Resident Evil, because of the limitations of the technology, it wasn't just this 3D room where you really walked around. Every camera angle was completely planned. And so thinking about working in dabbling in that kind of a domain.
Yeah. I'd love to make a survival horror game myself.
But
you know.
Going back to that, where every shot, it's not just your camera's bouncing around over your shoulder wherever it points, but actually tightly blocked, you know, with the cinematography and everything. I think that would be really, really fun thing to work on.
I agree. But in terms of influences, I've got just a couple that come to mind. Katamari Damacy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I have to say, prior to playing that game, I probably had never given a second thought to being a game dev. But that really started me thinking on games. Because when that came out, there was nothing else like it. Mm-hmm. And it also, aesthetically, it just has this kind of naive beauty to it. It's there's nothing really outrageous. There's lots of little humor. There's very careful set pieces of stacks of certain kinds of objects. It always seemed really beautiful to me. Mm-hmm. And then the other, of course, is Jet Set Radio.
And I think something those two games have in common is the feeling of the music matching the play of the game so well, which is something, you know, now that we're working with Montgomery Ward, I feel like we are moving in that direction a little bit of trying to integrate our musical experience and our gameplay experience and our whole vibe.
Yeah.
As influenced by those and probably a bajillion other games that aren't at the tip of my tongue right now.
But Jet Set Radio is actually a great example of a franchise I'd love to work on. Mm. I think if I had to choose one, that would be it.
I'm trying to picture Beardo, like with Miles doing the art. Like it would be, I want it, but I don't know what I think of it. Like
what it even looks like.
Yeah.
All our stuff is
pretty at the same time.
All our stuff is pretty 2D right now too. Yeah. We're in a kind of learning phase of thinking about down the road if we do work on 3D projects with this, because Miles' art style is, even though he's a sculptor, literally a sculptor in his day job, in his digital art, everything's been 2D. So what does a Beardo art style even look like?
But at the same time, there's games, getting back to fighting games again, there's Guilty Gear Xrd, where it looks like beautifully drawn 2D, but in reality it's all 3D. So that's always a possible route we could go down, just to use shaders to make it look 2D.
Oh, sure, sure.
I don't know.
His style, you can tell Miles I said this, not that it matters, but I feel like his style would translate incredibly well to that, like, uncanny valley side of 3D, where it's like, you know, it looks like real, but it also makes me feel like I'm in trouble a little bit. I was talking to Will Brierly, who is working on Vivian Clark and Soda Drinker Pro Neat Video Games, coming out soon. And he told me about a secret project he's working on. I can't tell you the details. You guys would really like it, though. I can tell you after the show.
Cool.
he found a modeling program where you just type in numbers and it makes like semi-realistic faces. And then you just got to tweak them a little bit. So I'm like, how'd you find that? He's like, forums?
Wow.
You know, Will, he just like, he does amazing things and then just giggles about it like it's nothing afterwards. He's a neat guy. Anyway, I would love also for you to do Resident Evil, because your stuff is kind of scary, but fun. Just like how Resident Evil.
We would definitely be doing at the camp end of the survival horror.
I think that's the end of it that's been forgotten by the series. After, I mean, after really it was starting to go that way with Resident Evil 3, where it kind of lost that. And part of it is the, you know, the LOL, she just said he just said you're the master of unlocking. Ha ha.
I know, once the internet comes in, it's hard for it to be yours anymore. And you feel like people are just like mockery culture infects your brain and it's not the same anymore. But yeah, I loved playing the first Resident Evil and wondering like, how am I supposed to be feeling?
Yeah.
Scared the crap out of me, and now I'm watching a guy go like this and talking about keys and whatnot.
Yeah, it was a really unique place in time because it captured almost everything about that era of horror movies, but like late 70s, early 80s horror movies,
mm-hmm.
where the production values are incredibly low, and some of the scenes just come off as laughable today.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's really, whether they were going for that or
and
not. That's
when I look
captured.
At the Resident Evil house, I think a little bit about Clue, the movie with Tim Curry mm-hmm. as the butler. And I think there's some intersectionality potential between Resident Evil and Tim Curry. And that's like the way I would want to go.
That is a dream come true. If you guys made a Clue game where maybe somebody was a zombie and like super gross... Because isn't that so scary to think, like, to me, zombies are terrifying because...
And then
like
you made out with them.
No! Oh, I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it now. Because it's like, you know, you look like a person, but maybe you're just a disgusting monster that wants to eat me and turn me into something as gross as you. Like, that's the nightmare of human interaction, to, like, meet someone who's metaphorically like a zombie and just makes you a diseased, gross person. That is so scary. And Miles' style... If you were to make out with those people, and if they, you know, didn't have your best interest at heart, you may be in trouble later on in the night. Jeez. Woof.
Yeah, true.
I'm excited about what you guys might be doing in the future. It might make you feel really weird. That's fun.
If we've made you feel really weird about it, our job is done.
You did it. You did it, because that's how people want to feel. And I think they feel weird, because there is... like kernels of truth to what you're putting out there. And it wouldn't, like, that guy wouldn't have run away from your game if it didn't make him feel like something real was kind of happening. Something true was kind of happening. He went running because he really didn't want to have his tongue touch that person's tongue. That scared the
metaphorically
crap out
or otherwise, you know,
right? Yeah. And right. If his mom was playing the game with someone else, even more so.
Yeah.
Oh, I wonder if he was just embarrassed. I was at a comedy show last night, actually, judging it. I don't know why. did I tell you this already?
No.
I don't know. I was judging the Boston Comedy Festival. It was the second night I did it. I was judging it alongside Emmanuel Lewis.
Oh my God.
I was too shy to say much to him. I just went, hello.
You weren't like, will you sign my forehead?
I was thinking, did you go super fan on him?
Yeah.
I was tempted, but since we were both judges, I had to be like, you're my peer, dog. Everything's cool. But I really just wanted to
decorum.
Be like, that one episode where you found the secret passage and man was like, oh my God, where's Webster? I was so scared. I just wanted to be sure. But yeah, I was sitting next to an older couple judging this comedy show, and it got like really raunchy about like genitals and whatnot, and I wanted to get up and run. So maybe that's how your game made that guy feel, like hanging out with his parents talking about genitals.
Just he was talking about genitals with Emmanuel Lewis.
That's it. That wow. And
in a very special episode.
This is just the excitement talking, but I'm spitting it out anyway. I've got connections to Emmanuel Lewis now, and you can make video games. Talking about genitals and the man Lewis, the game, pay what you want on itch.io. That could be money to make, you guys.
It could be like a talk show kind of video game where, you know, you're bringing on guests to talk about genitals with Emmanuel Lewis
is interviewing guests about.
Who hasn't thought about that? Well, I guess no one. We are the first ones to think about it. But everyone's felt that. Watching Maury, and it's like, you're famous, but you're not famous. You're getting so personal with these strangers, and you really
should. But you're not asking the right questions.
Yeah. Yeah.
The questions only Emmanuel Lewis could ask.
Yes.
The real Emmanuel Lewis might write the questions.
Yeah.
Like, it would be an authentic autobiographical, but this actually never happened game about Emmanuel Lewis and his guests. A dream come true. Anyway, well, you've got my emails now, so we'll talk about that later. And we started the show a little late, but we also went a little late, so I don't know when we're supposed to stop anymore. I'm assuming we should wrap it up. And what better note to wrap it up on than that? Probably a lot of other notes would be better, actually. But anyway, we're wrapping up on that one. You're at Beardo Games on Twitter.
That's right. Yes. And www.beardogames.com. is where our website is.
So many
where you can see a link to our trailer.
Yeah, I want people to see all the things you did. And I'm so glad you're going to continue to make stuff. As for me, I'm at Tron Knots on Twitter. You can follow me to find out about stuff that's happening, I guess. And you can watch the show later on YouTube, youtube.com/supholmeshow. You can listen to it on Libsyn and iTunes. And I think that's about it. Great. Thanks so much, everybody. Take care.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot.